I'm Archbishop Allen Vigneron of the Archdiocese of Detroit, and this is the Eyes on Jesus podcast.
Hello, and welcome to the Eyes on Jesus podcast with Archbishop Vigneron. I'm your host, Mike Chamberland.
And I'm your host, Mary Wilkerson.
We are excited to release new episodes once a month, so please make sure to subscribe and review wherever it is that you listen to podcasts. Archbishop, welcome, and thank you for joining us once again.
Oh, so good to be with you, Mike. Mary, glad to be here.
Archbishop, I know it's been obviously very historic, crazy kind of times the last number of months. How have you been doing yourself this last month with COVID and with having to, obviously isolate yourself? How have you been doing personally?
Like everybody else, I think, Mike, I feel this is a great trial. It's an opportunity for me to have more trust in the Lord. I believe very much that these are days he wants us to have. He can bring good out of them. I'm getting a lot of consolations as well during this time, especially as I become aware of what the priests are doing in order to be creative and advance their priestly ministry. A couple of things. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, as a father or shepherd, are you feeling very proud of your priests right now for the ingenuity that they're doing?
Yeah, way proud. Getting reports especially about the fruit that's being borne by the creativity of the priests in hearing confessions, finding ways to be more available to hear confessions in ways that are safe, observe social distance, and I'm very grateful for that.
That's awesome.
That's wonderful. How have you, I know this last month we obviously celebrated Easter, and are there any particular ways that you kind of celebrated Easter with joy in this unique kind of time and season?
One of my great joys was the celebration of the second Sunday of Easter, Divine Mercy Sunday, and after Mass was concluded, to carry the Blessed Sacrament out to the porch of the cathedral and offer a blessing to the city and to our whole archdiocese. That for me was very, very meaningful.
That was a pretty wonderful, profound moment to watch as it was being kind of streamed to look at. Are you getting more comfortable with doing masses at the cathedral kind of solo? Is it coming more naturally? Is it still quite uncomfortable? What is it like?
I wouldn't say it's uncomfortable. It's gotten into a bit of a routine. Mm-hmm. I feel really blessed to be able to be connected that way. Whatever is the peculiarity of it is far outweighed by the blessing of being able to be in touch with so many people. And I'm getting a lot of feedback that offers thanks and expresses gratitude. And if it helps people, then that warms my heart as a priest. That's my job as a priest, is to help people get close to Christ.
It's so nice to feel kind of connected during this
time.
Oh,
yeah.
And speaking of that, this week you put out a letter to the faithful, and I thought it was so well done because it acknowledged this longing for the Eucharist that we're feeling. Do you want to share anything about that, why you decided to put that letter out, what your thinking was behind it?
Well, it seemed like the right time. We've been in the stay-at-home, stay-safe mode for a significant amount of time. I am getting letters from people saying, please, Bishop, consider how soon we can gather together. I wanted to acknowledge that that's a very understandable and solid kind of feeling. And I want to assure people that we're not just on automatic pilot, but in fact, several times a week, I and those of us in leadership review the situation, and we're monitoring this very closely. And as soon as we think it's prudent, we'll begin some sort of return on the path to normalcy. But we're going to have to do it in a way that makes sense, that's prudent. And I know prudence can sound like a kind of fussy Victorian word, but prudence just means good common practical sense. It's the kind of judgment moms have when they tell their 12-year-old that it's going to be 20 degrees and you do need to wear your coat today.
Yes.
That's prudence.
That's a good way to kind of bridge that gap of understanding. And I know there's like an expression of, you know, feeling seen. And when I read that letter as a member of the faithful, it was good for me to hear the acknowledgement of this longing that we're feeling, because, you know, at first it's kind of a novelty to watch live stream masses, you know, and you're like, oh, we're kind of all in this together. But as time goes on, it's almost painful because, you know, we're Eucharistic people and we gather together in community and we share in the sacrifice. And it's hard to watch it on TV week after week, you know?
Yeah. No, there was a really fine article that I saw in the latest issue of the National Catholic Register by our own professor, Dr. Healy. Mary Healy teaches here at Sacred Heart. Mm-hmm. And she offered some reflections based on sacred scripture about what God's doing and how his providence is at work in this time. And she said that perhaps one of the things we can take away from this experience is to examine our consciences and see if we've taken the Holy Eucharist for granted. How often do people say, well, I could do this or I could do that, and maybe presuming that the Mass is always going to be there as one more choice. And if that's what God's doing, and I don't know, God's ways in history are mysterious, but if that's the grace he's offering, and it very well may be that he's offering that grace, then that there's where the blessing lies, to appreciate that we do so long to have the Eucharist, which is a longing for our beloved. And in our history, people have died in order to be able to get to the Holy Eucharist. I think of the great tradition of the mass stones in penal Ireland, people gathering in the dead of night, or the priest holes in England. As you say, Mary, if from all of this we are deepened in our appreciation, then that's a good fruit that's coming from an evil thing.
You're so right. You had said in a previous podcast that, and it really hit me, that we almost sometimes, some of us, me in the front of the line, will go to worship on a Sunday and almost expect congratulations. You know, I made it here with all my kids, so yay for me. And I think I myself had kind of fallen into a little bit of that trap, especially having young children. And I found myself on Sunday watching the live stream children's mass, like you said, just weeping for the senses of being at Mass, for the feel of the pew and kneeling down and the smell of the candles, all of the things that we experience, as well, of course, as the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus. But like you said, I'm not sure in the near future I will take the Eucharist for granted again like I have in my life. It's very easy to when it's always there at whatever time is convenient for me, you know? So that I think that'll be a fruit in my own life.
I do, Mary, and it's not just about you and the lay faithful. I think it's true for me, and not unlikely for a lot of us priests to be living through this on our way to a renewed appreciation of of the privilege it is to minister to God's people.
Yeah. That's great. Well, thank you for sharing that, and thank you so much for the letter. It helped, I think, to have us feel connected in this really tough time, and your live streams and all the communication that you're doing, and like you said, so many priests are doing, it helps to keep us feeling very strongly part of our faithful community. So that's important.
Archbishop, I know many of our schools and our teachers in our Catholic schools have done a wonderful job turning on a dime and really quickly making adjustments to how they teach. And I know that by the end of this month, many of them are coming to a close for their remote learning for the year. Did you have any particular message for the students and for the teachers, especially maybe even the seniors that are graduating at this time, again, with these weird, weird circumstances?
Well, for the whole school community, the teachers and the students, a word of gratitude for everybody's flexibility and investment in continuing the mission of our Catholic schools, even during the pandemic. We say very strongly that our schools have a mission. They're an apostolate. And the sacrifices that the teachers especially and the leaders, the principals have made, but the students and the parents as well, to continue doing mission That's one way to think about it. And I give God praise and thanks for people's fidelity to the mission of Catholic schools. Mm-hmm. And about seniors, this is perhaps a call to be ready, to be prepared. They have completed their course of study. They're moving on, some of them to trades, some to the military, some to higher education. This is a time of great testing, and we've done our very best as a community in our schools to help them get ready for that. And they can be confident in building on this foundation, which is academically sound, but also humanly, spiritually sound as a formation to be able to move forward with faith and hope.
Have you thought, Archbishop, about some of these milestones that were missing during this time of stay at home? You know, there's the graduations, even the priestly ordinations. One of my priest friends brought up, they're going to look different, these men that have been preparing for years. How do we kind of find comfort in some of those big moments looking so different this year?
Well, the first place I start, Mary, and I said this a little earlier, is that as much as I would like them to be different, this is the way God wants to give them to me right now. Mm-hmm. And if I cooperate with him, if I I can only do this by the power of his Spirit, to accept his decree about how I'm going to, for example, ordain these men this year. Mm-hmm. If I can do that, he will give me the strength to do that, then there'll be something better. This is a theme, I think, even in St. Thomas Aquinas, if I recall my reading accurately, that God permits evil so that he can bring something better if we are willing to cooperate with his providential plan.
That is,
but it's
good
sad.
Comfort.
It's very difficult. One of the things I think is very difficult, and it's not an annual marking, but is people not being able to have funerals, big funerals. I mean, we can have very small sorts of opportunities for burials, we have norms for that, and the priests apply them, I think, very, very prudently, but. Not to be able to have a regular funeral for people we mourn and miss, I think that's very difficult.
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah. But it's good to kind of remind ourselves that God is in control, so I appreciate that reminder, that it's not a chaotic situation, that our faith grounds us with the working of the Spirit.
Well, and reminds me of something my mother used to say in her own, I think, very plain-spoken witness as a disciple. Something bad would happen, and she'd say, I don't know how people who don't have faith can get along. Mm-hmm. And we do. Uh-huh. It's faith that is the light to help us move forward.
Yep. Very good.
Well, Archbishop, this is the month of May. I know it's a very special month for both Mary and I because we both celebrate birthdays in this month, but it's...
Happy birthday.
40 years old, Archbishop Vigneron. 40 years old for Mike and I.
Both of us, yeah. But
you're young.
Yeah.
That's true.
But it's obviously more important of a month because we always celebrate it in the church as the month of Mary. And so I know today we wanted to maybe talk about a little bit about that as a Marian month, but also its cross-section, obviously, with this time of the pandemic and everything we're going through and everything. So if you wouldn't mind, Archbishop, would you tell us a little bit about where that kind of emerged as May being kind of the month of Mary and dedicated to Mary and the celebration of that?
Well, Mike, you gave me a little heads up that I might have a question like this, and I did some research, and what I found is nobody really knows for sure how far back the dedication of May to Mary goes, but that what we do know is it started as just an instinct among the faithful, and over time, the pastors of the church, including our Holy Fathers, the popes, have blessed this instinct and built on it.
Very good. Yeah,
so I guess the simplest, it seems like the Holy Spirit did it in the rank and file of the church.
Yeah, look at that.
I love that. What are some special ways that you honor Mary during this month personally? Like, are there things that you do differently in the month of May to keep your focus on, you know, Our Lady and the role that she is in our lives?
One of the things that's very important for me is to keep the Saturdays of the month as especially dedicated to Our Lady. This is also a custom in the life of the church. And there's promulgated by St. John Paul II a set of really rich Mass prayers. And so in May, I try to be attentive to that in particular, to keep my Saturdays dedicated to Our Lady.
Nice. Growing up, did you have any traditions during the month of May within your family or within your school life?
Well, one of the most important things I learned from the sisters in school was I needed to have a May altar. And I had a little statue of Our Lady. And with my mom's permission, I could cut a couple of flowers out of the garden and put them on my May altar. That's what I think about right now.
You talk about the mission of Catholic school teachers, and one of the challenges my son had that I didn't realize he was working independently was to make a little May altar. So I looked in the corner of his bed. He had made construction paper flowers and put his rosary on top of that. And I thought that was such a neat little reminder for him that May is a little different and to be mindful of the Blessed Mother during this month. Any May crownings when you were growing up? Was that part of your schooling?
It was part of our experience in the parish. My youngest brother told me a story the other day. We sang on Sunday at the end of the live stream Mass, Immaculate Mary. There was a May crowning in the cathedral. Father Meck and I performed that rite. And he said it took him back to his childhood and remember hearing my mom sing the Lord's hymn during the May crowning at the parish. And I thought that was it made it real for me.
That's very sweet. One of my girlfriends was singing to her son one of the Marian hymns, and I think many of us that grew up Catholic can remember our moms singing those hymns, and I hope my kids remember that too when they grow up, you know. That's good.
Wonderful. I know this this obviously, especially with the month of Mary, we think of Mary very much as an intercessor for us. She's always working on our behalf. And so would you mind talking to that just for a moment, Archbishop? Like, what does, just taking it back to basics, what does intercession really mean? And why do we believe this, you know, from our saints that all intercede, but Mary, of course, as the best intercessor, if you will?
Yeah, let's start with just intercession as such. We can pray for one another. It's throughout the New Testament. It's not any one particular place that speaks of that. And if when Christians are still alive on this earth, we can pray for one another and support one another, and certainly we can have that supportive prayer from those who have already gone to God, and we are sure stand in front of his throne. I was reading a commentary on the book of Revelation just last night, and the author points out that throughout the book of Revelation, it's very clear that those who stand before the throne of God in heaven are interceding and have an impact on the unfolding of God's plan for salvation. About Our Lady, perhaps the two most important witnesses to that are, first of all, the fact that Jesus gave her to us when he was dying on the cross. She's our mother, and he asked us to take her, to behold her, to accept her. And it's out of that confidence that we come to her. And another very important witness is her intercession at the wedding feast of Canaan, that she presents the need of the bride and groom to Jesus and is confident that he will respond in his own wisdom. I think it's something that, we've got good doctrinal grounds for it, but I think it's also confirmed for us just by our own solid Catholic sentiments.
So when you think of your own life, and obviously it's become very clear to me meeting for these podcasts that you have quite a devotion to Our Lady, specifically Our Lady of Lourdes, but is there a time in your life where you've really leaned on the intercession of Mary and felt particularly close to her through an experience or through a trial or anything like that?
Well, I'm like any kid, you know, you can take your mom for granted until you need her, and then you you kind of run into the house.
Yes.
So I particularly, I suppose, am attentive to Our Lady's help when I'm in a time of stress and challenge. When the Holy Father sent me to California, to Oakland, to be the bishop, that was a challenge. I didn't know anybody there. Had to really pick up my whole life and move. And I would say that in those months especially of getting accustomed to a new diocese, a new state, I relied greatly on the protection of Our Lady and a sense that I could move forward confidently under her protection.
Mike, have you ever had an experience where you've really leaned on the Blessed Mother for intercession or for prayer and felt strengthened by it or comforted by it?
I mean, the time that comes most immediately to mind is, my wife and I, we've unfortunately struggled in our marriage with infertility issues and things like that. And we were able to conceive, and my wife is pregnant 7 years ago, but unfortunately at 32 weeks we had a stillbirth, so we lost the child. And that image of the Pietà and the suffering mother, and just asking for her prayer and her help and her intercession for my wife and for myself during that time was particularly helpful. And I was I felt particularly drawn close to her at that time, for sure.
I love when we can think of Mary as like a mom, like a real, like you said, Archbishop Vigneron, you know, running into the house to her or being with her and her ability to suffer, you know, like she was really in it, you know.
Mary, that's what's really important behind the title, that one of the very first and most important titles the bishops of the church have solemnly given to Mary, Mother of God. And it's theologically correct, but what's also important about it is it stands as a marker to how real the incarnation is, that Jesus isn't an idea. He is God come in the flesh. And so Mary isn't just an idea. Mm-hmm. Mary is a person. She's the mom. And so all of the things that are so good about our humanity, our humanness, are brought up into our life in Christ. I guess I just would wind up repeating myself, but like a real, she's not just like a real mom.
Right.
She is
right.
A real mom.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
How about for you, Mary? Was there a particular time or moment for you that you leaned on Mary or had knew of her power of intercession at a certain time?
Yeah, that's, you know, Mike, I'm struck by your story a little bit because I walked through that with you guys, and I think that, that was a pretty profound thing to walk through and know that, you know, your story, I think the Blessed Mother was very close to you guys in that time. So when I think of the Blessed Mother, I think about that as well. And just little things. Somebody taught me in college this power of the three Hail Marys. And so whenever I am in need of like immediate intercession, for silly things and big things, I really pray the three Hail Marys for her intercession and believe strongly that you know, in those moments, she has the ear of Jesus. And so I can think of a million little times, even presenting sometimes when, you know, there's a tough crowd or I'm not sure what I'm doing in ministry and I'm not confident, just asking her to kind of intercede and make it okay and things will be okay, you know. So I see her moving in my life in little ways as well.
Mary, isn't it the case, though, that for a mother, I mean, you're the mom, I'm not, but I had one, she's gone to God. But my sense always was there wasn't little things for a mother.
Right.
If that's important to the child, it's important to the mother.
Yeah, I think that that, since having children, the role of the Blessed Mother has just become a totally different thing in my life. My husband, for Mother's Day, gave me this beautiful image of the Blessed Mother holding baby Jesus, and I can see it out my bedroom door. So when it's the middle of the night and I'm up with kids, a friend got me in a larger version of this same picture that I love, and I don't know what it's called. I wish I did, but my kids are up in the middle of the night and I'm tired and I want to go to bed, and I see this picture, and it brings me a different level of kind of comfort of Our Lady, you know, in who I am as a mother. So it's important, I think, like you said, Archbishop, to remember she isn't like a mother. She is a mother in all the ups and downs that come with being a mom. It's been important in who I am as a mom to relate to her that way. So that's good.
No, and I like your point. I mean, she's not an archetype. She's not just a mythological figure of motherhood. She was an actual mother. And I think that's great to remember.
And that's become more profound for me since being a mom. Like even the little things, like I'm saying, up in the middle of the night, like she was probably up in the middle of the night sometimes with Jesus and tired, you know? Mm-hmm. So being able to relate to her in that way has been a real gift.
Yeah. Well, Archbishop, I know obviously with the month of Mary and this pandemic, obviously, that we're seeing, I know different leaders around the world have been doing reconsecrations or first-time consecrations of their countries or as individuals to our Blessed Mother. I know many of us, I know myself included, did St. Louis de Montfort kind of personal consecration shortly after getting married. My wife and I both did that. Mary, I believe you've probably done that as well, right?
The consecration.
So can you speak a little bit, Archbishop, to what the idea is of consecrating either yourself as an individual or consecrating even like a country over to the hands of Mary and kind of where that came from?
I think to understand it, we need to begin with baptism. That in baptism, we are consecrated to God the Father in Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. We enter the covenant. And in a covenant, it's not just that stuff gets exchanged. It's not like a contract. You give me the sweatshirt, I give you my money. In a covenant, people give themselves to one another, a total gift of self. That's why marriage is a covenant. It's the most prominent natural covenant we know of. And so my understanding of these particular consecrations are that they're specifications of this baptism covenant, that there's an aspect of belonging to the church, belonging to God in the church, that we then freely highlight. And by the movement of the Holy Spirit, we're drawn to specify this baptism relationship in a very particular way. And I think with the Blessed Mother, because we're Christians, because we're disciples of Jesus, we do belong to Mary and she belongs to us. But like any good relationship, that needs to be articulated, it needs to be specified, needs to be highlighted. And for example, in Mexico, this belonging to Mary is highlighted under her title of Our Lady of Guadalupe. In the United States, the bishops of our country, all the way back to 1792, when there was one bishop for the United States, John Carroll, Our Lady, under the title of her Immaculate Conception, has been the way we specify our belonging to her. And because Jesus is the Lord of all times and all peoples, it's possible to put to direct the United States as a nation, particularly into the care of our Blessed Mother as the Immaculate.
And then when we do something like a consecration, and what do we hope will happen as a result? Because I think sometimes it can be tricky with intercession. You know, if we pray fervently enough or with enough hope, the pandemic will end, you know, which isn't necessarily how God is going to play out his will. And so what is our hope when we as a country decide we're going to consecrate ourselves, especially during a time like this?
Well, I think we are it's quite legitimate to hope that God will intervene and act powerfully to put an end to the plague. He has done that in times past, but we have to wait on his goodwill and confident that if it doesn't turn out that way, that that's better for us because God will never let something happen that is not ultimately for our happiness. I mean, we know this by faith that our happiness is more important to God than it is to us. And so if he answers our prayers in another way than what we have been pleading for, then we're confident that that's for our good.
You keep going back to that, and it's such a good faith reminder that the better is coming, and we trust and we have faith that God is moving. And not only is coming, is here. He's here in this right now. And with Our Lady's intercession, hopefully his will be shown, you know?
Yeah. But I know we're going to talk a little bit later, soon, about Our Lady of Lourdes. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that's very remarkable is that when St. Bernadette was moving to the end of her life with her final illness, they said, well, people said to her, you should go back to the grotto. She said, that's not for me. That's not what Our Lady wants for me. And I think that's, to me, a moving example of this abandonment to God's plan.
You just sort of alluded to it, Archbishop, but I know during the first live stream Mass on March 15th, you spoke in an emotional moment about entrusting the Archdiocese to Our Blessed Mother and announcing also that a grotto of Our Lady of Lourdes on the grounds of the cathedral will be built. What's your vision for that grotto, and is there anything more on that specifically that you'd like to share?
My vision for it is that it will stand as a reminder to all of us that our prayers were answered for Our Lady's intercession in these months. And we can promise to do it already because we can be sure that she is interceding for us. I have no doubt. Now, I don't know what the fruit of her intercession will be, but I know that she's hearing our pleas and praying for us and for our well-being. When I think about every place Our Lady has appeared, she always comes as an evangelist, as a herald of the good news. That's what she did to Juan Diego. That's what she did to the three children in Fatima. And that's what she did at Lourdes. And particularly her message, her good news there is that Jesus is with us in our sickness and in our time of trial. And I think that's what a Lourdes grotto attests to. It echoes Mary's message that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us, and he will never, ever go away. I find this powerfully presented to me when I think about what the Lourdes grotto is. You know, this was a place where they threw garbage, and the pigs used to go there to rot around. And that's where Mary decided to manifest her. Well, that's where she was sent by Jesus. And she's in that. That to me says that God is in our garbage. He's not afraid to be part of our mess. And that's to me what a Lourdes grotto bespeaks. God is with us.
That's a beautiful line. I love that. God is in our garbage. I mean, that's just,
I just
very,
wrote it down.
And it's very deep and very profound right there. Yeah. So thank you for that, Archbishop.
Did you have Archbishop, the idea or the prayer movement or feel the Spirit encouraging you to lead our diocese in creating this grotto prior to what's happened in 2020? And this just seemed like the moment to present it. What was kind of the process of making that decision for the diocese?
Father Mack, the cathedral rector, and I have talked about putting a grotto up on the grounds of the cathedral, and it's been a kind of wishful idea. Mm-hmm. And when the pandemic hit, I determined that now is the time to move forward. We're still in the initial planning stages. A few people have sent gifts toward the project, and I'm very grateful for that. But we don't, we're just beginning to talk about where it might be and what it might look like.
It seemed like a really spirit-heavy, I'll say, moment when you kind of announced that at that liturgy. Many people kind of, just on social media, I always reference that I see things on social media, talked about that moment and the passion by which you brought it up, and kind of just a real moment of hope in some darkness. So I look forward to seeing how that comes to play in the Archdiocese.
I do too. I'm not sure how we're going to do it, what the next steps are, but God will help us.
I think so. That's cool. Is there anything else that you wanted to add about Our Lady in this podcast as we kind of move forward? Any reflections or thoughts that we can kind of have during this month?
I'm not sure that how edifying this will be. I mean, I'm not cheerleading so much, but I'm moved right now to pay tribute to my parents, who had a very plain and unvarnished confidence in Our Lady, in what were, you know, the typical kinds of challenges that come to any married couple trying to raise six kids on a tight budget. And I really learned a lot from my mom and dad about just a plain, uncomplicated confidence in the Blessed Mother.
Which is a really powerful witness, I think, especially in this, I don't know, this time of noise. You know, there's just a lot of noise all around us, that there's a simplicity that I think if we connect back to, it'll deepen our faith. And I love when you speak about your parents and the way that they raised you, because it doesn't always necessarily seem like real extra. It was just they lived their faith. And the fact that with the Blessed Mother, they lived her intercession is a beautiful thing for, I think, any families and the lay faithful to remind us of how we should live. So thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome.
So at this time in the podcast, we ask the lay faithful from the Archdiocese of Detroit to submit their questions, and they can submit those questions to eyesonjesuspodcast@aod.org. And we take those questions, Archbishop Vigneron, and we get to ask them, ask you them. So what we'd like to do right now is go into the questions. But before I do that, I want to remind our listeners, anytime you feel that you might have a question that you'd like the Archbishop to answer, you can go ahead and email us at eyesonjesuspodcast@aod.org. So your first question today, Archbishop Vigneron, comes from James at St. Andrew's in Rochester. And James says, how did David's sin affect his relationship with God in the Old Testament?
I was very grateful for this question, because I've been thinking a lot about, over the years, God's affection for King David and why he made an irrevocable covenant with David that it was from David's stock that the Messiah would come. And God was faithful to that in spite of David's many sins. That's going to be one of my questions when we have the Last Judgment. When David's name is read out and we look at his case, I'm going to ask God, what did you like so much? What made David so blessed to you? From my read of the sacred scripture, it has to do with David's wholeheartedness, that he was all in, and he obviously was not all holy. He sinned with adultery. He arranged for the murder of Bathsheba's husband. But God had pity on him and saw in him something that was a ground of grace. Obviously, David's sins wounded in that relationship with God, and yet God remained faithful to David. And David was able, on the basis of God's fidelity, to return and repent. So I think David represents the mystery of sin and repentance in the life of every member of the covenant.
I love your point, Archbishop, about kind of David getting kind of that A for effort from God, like just the fact that he, that his passion that was there, and he was so all in, as you said. I really like that image. That's great.
And it doesn't excuse him for his sins.
Right, right.
But it provided a basis for God to act in his life. And yeah. God is faithful. God is always looking for ways to open up the cracks of our heart.
Second question we have here for you is from Shelley of St. Hugo's of the Hills in Bloomfield Hills. And she asks, what advice would you have for Catholics trying to stay pro-life from womb to tomb and live out our faith in this diverse climate, especially when our beliefs so often go misrepresented?
The way to begin, I believe, is to have confidence in the resurrection of Christ, which is the ultimate victory over evil. And this is not to in any way obscure the heinous crime of abortion and how awful it is that this is legitimated in our legal system. But Christ is risen. He will ultimately bring about victory, and that he is able to bring good out of this evil if we respond to his invitations about how we can do that. I find the history of the Christian people is a consolation about all of this, as we look at times when things seem so very dark and evil seem to be so triumphant. But in the end, God has brought us forward, and he will bring us through this. I think, yes, the climate is divisive. I think St. Peter says in one of his two epistles that we have to go about doing good and being patient and let our good example speak for us.
When it comes to kind of beliefs being misrepresented and just the difficulty sometimes of talking about these things in a way that is truthful and yet inviting towards truth, how do you kind of manage that as the Archbishop and having such a voice that's listened to? Do you really pray for prudence? How do you kind of maneuver through some of these harder issues to even talk about?
Yeah. I start, when it comes to this matter of being misrepresented, that our Lord promised that would happen. Mm. He said that if this is what they say about me, don't be surprised when they misrepresent you. Mm-hmm. And if God the Son in the flesh could be called Beelzebul, well, we shouldn't be surprised if we're mischaracterized. I also think Christ is the example to return receive all of that with patience, and so much so that he died asking the Father to forgive the people who misrepresented him, if you use a pretty weak word for what they did. And how to go about making our case, I think to do it with patience and with love, and to be firm, certainly, to be unambiguous, but at the same time to have not just the cause, in the front of our mind when we make our case, but also to be mindful of the need for salvation and God's love for the people who set themselves up against the truth.
All helpful reminders. Karen from St. Stephen, our last question for today in New Boston, would like to ask, what can the Catholic Church and the faithful do to support our brothers and sisters who struggle with sexual sin, especially as we live in such a sexualized, secular culture?
I think a really important place to begin in answering this question is to acknowledge that we do live in this toxic milieu of a highly eroticized culture that seems to say at every turn that erotic satisfaction is the ultimate happiness in life. And so this is not easy to maintain chastity in this milieu. What can the church do? Well, for us as pastors, the most important thing is to continue to hold up the gospel way of life along with our Lord's promise that he will give us the strength we need to live this life of heroic virtue, and also the promise that forgiveness is available when or if someone falls. For the rank and file of the faithful, I think it's really important for all of us to give encouragement each to the other, to call out the lie about the eroticized culture, to support one another in our resolutions, to avoid the near occasions of sin. There are a lot of things that seem to be legitimate in our forms of entertainment that in fact provoke temptation. And we need to support one another in the discipline of avoiding those experiences that tend to inflame our passions and bring us to temptation. So that's spiritual friendship is important. Also to encourage one another in asceticism. A very important way to avoid sins against chastity is to practice asceticism in other feelings, other what the theologians call passions in that generic sense, to practice asceticism about my comfort, to practice asceticism about my appetite for food, for luxuries, for things that make life easier. And we can do that for one another. One of the things I keep in mind is the practice that St. Philip Neri used to do when he heard confessions. If he thought a sinner presented a sin that merited a very vigorous penance, St. Philip would impose the penance, but then he'd say to the penitent, "And I'll do that for you. I will do your penance. All you have to do is," I mean, you give them something simple like three Hail Marys or some such thing. So we can do that for one another. We can make up what's lacking in one another's spiritual life too.
That's really beautiful. I had never heard that about St. Philip. What a good witness in terms of leaning into one another for strength, you know, and I think some of that is it necessitates honest conversation sometimes. And I think sometimes the evil uses keeping all of this in the dark so that we don't talk openly about some of the ways to counter it, right?
Oh, exactly. Yeah. The shadow, the dark, is the great ally of the evil one. Light. The light of Christ is the great inoculation against the evil one.
Which I always think is really profoundly shown in the Sacrament of Reconciliation. You know, when you go in and you feel you know, such darkness and shame and all of those things that sometimes lead to you to go to the sacrament of reconciliation, and the feeling afterwards of bringing things to the light and hearing you're forgiven. You know, I think that's a key part too.
That is one of the most important graces of the sacrament. Mm. I know that some people don't understand why we have the mediation of the priestly ministry in the sacrament, but there's a great freedom in being able to say before, out loud, in front of God and through his priest, I am this, whatever the this is, and I know you love me. Mm. That I am this, and you can name the worst possible sin in that blank.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I am this, but I trust that God loves me and will forgive me. That is a powerful liberation from the chain of the devil, because above all things, his lie to us is, you are unlovable.
Well, Archbishop, before we ask for a close the episode with a blessing, I wanted to ask you if there was anything in particular that those listening, and of course Mary and myself, if there's anything specific we could pray for you, any special intentions you have or anything specific that you desire us to pray for you for.
I think particularly I'd ask everybody to join with me in praying for our pastors, our priests, as they work so diligently to be of service to God's people in these trying times. And also, in the next few weeks, we're going to have the ordination of the seminarians as deacons and the ordination of deacons to the priesthood. So specifically when it comes to those called to the priesthood, pray for these young men.
You got it, Archbishop. Would you mind, Archbishop, closing us with a final prayer and blessing?
Glad to do it. Let's. We've spoken so much about Our Lady. I don't know that we need to do three, like Mary said, but we'll do the Hail Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
Amen.
Our Lady of Lourdes, pray for us. Blessed Solanus, pray for us. And may Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Archbishop.
You're welcome. Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Mary.
Stay tuned for the next episode of Eyes on Jesus, a new episode every month. And if you enjoyed listening, you might also like the Open Door Policy Podcast with Father Steve Pullis and Danielle Center, a podcast for joyful missionary disciples and our movement to unleash the gospel. Find it on your favorite podcast app.